The topic for today's session is how to manage weight effectively while working from home. And to guide us how, we have with us today, Ms. Harshita Dilawri Sachdev. With over 12 plus years of experience in health, nutrition and diabetic education, Harshita possesses a great zeal to help people maintain and attain good health through natural and day-to-day foods. She is a passionate nutritionist, diabetic educator, and a metabolic balance coach with a background in both therapeutic nutrition as well as food science nutrition. Being a life member of Indian Dietetic Association as well as Indian Diabetic Association, she keeps updating the new diet and concepts about nutrition. Having international work experience in Denmark, she is knowledgeable about not just the local Indian diets, but international diets as well. For the convenience of everyone, we would be happy to take the questions at the last and would request you to please enter all your queries and questions in Q&A tab. Now, without taking any more time, I would request Ms. Harshita to please take over from here. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Surbhit, and a very good afternoon to everyone. It's a pleasure to be connected with you all, but I'm hoping we are all alert after that mighty lunch. So this webinar is about a relevant and very interesting topic, which we all can relate to. Sometime or the other, we all work from home for a number of reasons. Maybe we are a stay-at-home parent, or maybe our office space is under renovation, or maybe we have been working from a different country, away from headquarters, or for any challenging situations like today's. But what comes with work from home is the inevitable weight gain and the stress of how to lose this weight in an effective manner. Because it's important to ensure we are being productive, happy, and healthy while being homebound, it's important that the weight loss should be optimal. So today, here are some of the things I'll be talking about in a very simplified way so that each of us can understand easily. That is nutrition and its components. Are you being overweight, working from home, and overall health? Nutrition tips that will aid weight loss, home-based exercise, sample plan, and lastly, I'll take all the Q&As. Now, coming on to the nutrition, in simple words, it is the study of nutrients in food, how the body uses them, and the relationship between diet, health, and disease. So broadly, there are two components of nutrients, macro and micronutrients, from which we get our nutrition on everyday basis. Macronutrients comprise of carbohydrates, proteins, and fats, while micro are vitamins and minerals. Though water is not included as a nutrient, needless to say how important it is for our health and living. Now, this is a beautiful slide which says how a typical diet consists of a balance of both macro and micronutrients. Now, looking at one of the most important macronutrients that most of us are scared these days is carbohydrates. We all know how a typical Indian diet consists of mostly carbs, but nonetheless, they're essential for our daily living and fiber. We need to get that energy. However, we must consume maximum 4 to 5 servings a day, including complex carbs like whole wheat flour, corn, red or brown rice, jowar, bajra, nachni, which is ragi, fruits and vegetables, barring the intake of sugar, sweetened beverages, and of course, maida, which is refined flour. So coming on to the proteins, we all know that it's needed for the repair of tissues and are the building blocks of bones, muscles, cartilage, skin, and blood. We need to ensure of having at least one serving of protein in each meal. And here in the picture, we can see how different vegetarian sources are giving good amount of proteins like dals, our regular dals, rajma, chana, chola, moong dal, etc. And soybean, which is one of the most, you know, important protein we vegetarians are having because it gives us all the essential amino acids. So this slide shows some of the non-veg sources of proteins, which are believed to have good biological value also and can be had at least one serving per meal, barring the red meats and the daily or processed meats like sausages, bacon, etc. So coming on to the healthy fats, let's be assured that healthy fats are not bad at all. It's the portion that we need to count on. A small amount of fat is an essential part of a healthy and balanced diet, as this helps to absorb fat-soluble vitamins like A, D, E, and K, and needed for energy and supporting the cell growth. Now, as per NCEP, which is National Cholesterol Education Program, and AHA, which is American Heart Association, the ideal ratio is SFA, MUFA, PUFA, which is saturated fatty acids, monounsaturated fatty acids, and polyunsaturated fatty acids. The ideal ratio should be 1:1.3:1, where we can get a moderate consumption of MUFA, which is needed to control our cholesterol, and LDL, which is a bad cholesterol. Now, we can get our MUFA-rich oils from groundnut oil, rice bran oil, canola oil, etc. Now, this amounts to 3 teaspoons of oil per person per day and 1 teaspoon of ghee per person per day. Needless to say, we must refrain from saturated fats like butter, margarine, vanaspati, etc. So now, coming on to the interesting part is how to identify if you are actually gaining weight while sitting, besides the body and clothes telling us. So there are few indicators, like BMI, which is our body mass index, waist circumference, waist to hip ratio, and body type. Now, these also guide us in case of any health risks like cardiovascular diseases, especially heart diseases or stroke, then diabetes, musculoskeletal diseases like osteoarthritis, and some cancers. So this is the BMI or body mass index chart, which is basically a measure of your body fat, and it is based on height and weight, and we can easily calculate by our weight in kilograms divided by height in meter square. And these are the various cutoffs, and an individual is considered healthy when the BMI falls between 18.5 to 24.9, as you all can see over here. And more than 30 is considered to be an obese, which is of course dangerous and may contribute to health risks. Now this chart shows directly our BMI and the health zones in colored form. For example, if your height is 5'4", which is 162.5 meters, and if your weight is 54 kilograms, you can intersect your BMI easily. Now here, if I calculate my height is 162.5 and if I'm weighing 54 kilograms, my BMI is coming to be 21, which is a green zone. While the blue zone is showing an underweight, yellow is overweight, obese is orange, and red being morbid obesity. Next indicator is showing here, that is waist to hip ratio, and you can easily calculate by your waist in centimeters, divide by your hips in centimeters. So here, if you'll see that the good norm is for males when you're following in 0.85 to 0.89, and for females, the healthy range is between 0.75 to 0.79. Of course, we should consider to have an excellent norm. For the next waist circumference, the next indicator, you can refer it to the next table. Here you can directly measure your waist size, and here for females within 27.5 inches or less than 70 centimeters is considered to be very low risk, while 31.5 inches for males and less than 80 centimeters, again, for males, it is considered to be very low risk, and the high being more than 43.5 in females and then 47 inches in males. Now, there are broadly two body shapes, apple and pear. Here, if the waist circumference is higher than the hip circumference, then you have an apple-shaped body, typically seen in males, having more of visceral or belly fat. Now, this visceral fat is stored around the organs and they have health risks. On the contrary, if you have a smaller waist circumference than hip circumference, then you have a pear-shaped body seen more in females. Okay, so now over here, I'm sure many of us can relate to that is working from home can sometimes be a blessing and it can sometimes be a curse. As we see the advantages, like it's flexible schedule, sitting in your cozy clothes, there's no commuting. Of course, there's no stress of crowd and traffic. While the disadvantages being there's lack of willpower, then we are taking power naps or cat naps in between. We are bored at times, then there's slow in work, connectivity issues, and of course, there is impact on health. Then broadly, we categorize all the health issues in three forms: nutritional, physical, focus on your nutrition, physical today. So on the basis of nutrition or lack of physical activity, we see some of the common medical problems arising from a sedentary lifestyle, like eating, slowing down of metabolism, then one becomes lazy and lethargic. There is digestive issues like reflux or constipation and several other issues. However, I'm going to talk only few in detail. So eating disorders at this point of time, this is a common response related to work-life distress or being isolated or having unending access to those chips, chocolates, cooking lying in the pantry, or eating just out of boredom. Studies suggest these eating disorders can activate the pleasure center of your brain, but can also psychologically remove you from the negative emotion that you're feeling that moment. So that's why we keep eating our comfort food. And in these trying times, now that, you know, mostly we are working from home, all we think from morning till night is food, right? So these disorders can be classified as anorexia nervosa, where a person is self-starving themselves, there is excessive weight loss. And these people, they have intense fear of becoming fat and they see themselves as fat even when they are very, very thin. Then is bulimia, which is an eating disorder. It involves binging on food followed by purging or throwing up of food. Then is binge eating, which is our current scenario, I'm sure. This is different though. Here people will eat regularly and they will eat a lot of food in just a few hours, even when they are not hungry, just to drown out emotions. Then they quickly feel shame or guilt about it. And then lastly, stress eating, which is consuming food in response to your feeling, especially when you are sad or confused, like overeating or undereating. Now, how to deal with the binge eating disorders? There are several ways where we can reduce the behavioral eating patterns, like ditching the diets. It's very, very important not to go into crash diet just to, you know, get out of that increase in weight, because studies, they show that fasting or eliminating certain foods from your diet are associated with increased cravings and overeating. So try and follow a healthy eating instead of dieting or cutting out certain foods completely. Then it's important to avoid any meal, for that matter, a breakfast, lunch, or dinner. Sticking to a regular eating pattern can reduce the risk of overeating, and it's associated with lower levels of ghrelin, which is a hunger hormone, and fasting blood sugar. Then it's important to practice mindfulness, because this will give you, it will help you recognize that you're no longer hungry, and it can eventually improve your eating behavior. Then stay hydrated. It's very important because sometimes we are not at all hungry, but just thirsty. And if you keep drinking a lot of water, you'll get that feeling to decrease the calorie intake and prevent binge eating eventually. Then try yoga. It's a wonderful, wonderful tool, and it can prevent binge eating and may reduce triggers like stress, depression, anxiety. Then stay away from junk, of course, removing all the unhealthy foods from your kitchen and stock up on healthy alternatives. It can surely improve diet quality and make it harder to binge eat. Then feel full, like eat your fiber really well, because fiber can really give you a feeling of fullness and ultimately will not lead you into binge eat. Then sleep well, because there are studies that are linked that, you know, if you're eating disorders, you know, for example, binge eating, it is linked to insomnia, and sleep deprivation has been shown to alter the level of hormones affecting hunger and appetite. talk to somebody. It's very important, either your friend, your family, or take a professional help, because a good social support is linked to decreased binge eating and stress. And lastly, keep food journal or mood journal with you, because they can help identify triggers to address potential problems. And there are studies that these diaries, the food or the mood diaries, associated with fewer episodes of binge eating. Now, sluggish metabolism, and how can we boost the same? Another side effect of being working from home is sluggish metabolism. And what is metabolism? It is just a process by which our body converts what we eat and drink into energy, along with, but you know, we've seen that prolonged sitting hours, it tends to slow down the metabolism and results in metabolic problems. For example, weight gain, insulin insensitivity, fatty liver, diabetes, etc. And it's also seen that metabolism is also slowed down when you do a lot of fresh diets or repeated diets. However, there are certain ways by which we can boost the same, like increasing the physical activity, eating regular timings, then proper hydration, proper sleep, and including our very own kitchen herbs and spices. They are very, very powerful, and they are lying in India, you know, and across the world in our kitchen already. For example, black pepper, ajwain, zira, cinnamon, etc. Now, these kitchen herbs, they contain bioactive compounds that stimulate the thermogenic effect of food, which means that they can optimally burn the calorie, but in a slow manner. Okay, now there are so many supplements floating in the market, and they're promoted as fat burners or metabolism burners. However, studies are very less that they can actually help you to lose weight, because the healthy way to, you know, to sustain your weight loss is cutting calories from your extra diet and exercise more frequently. There are certain guidelines in accordance with ICMR and WHO. Now, number one is make friends your vegetables. It's very, very important that, you know, you have to have at least 1 to 2 servings of vegetables at each meal, because they are low calorie, they're high in fiber, they contain good amount of micronutrients like vitamins and minerals, and they have plenty of antioxidants. Then go, don't be afraid from carbs, please. They are needed at each point of time, otherwise you will be cranky. However, we have to limit our dense carbohydrates like sugar, donuts, and cupcakes, etc. It's important to choose lean meats. You can have your regular dals, your lentils, you can have chicken, egg, fish, tofu, etc. Then have healthy fats like sesame oil, groundnut oil, homemade ghee, white butter, etc. Then it's very important to hydrate yourself often, because, you know, the more water you will take, it will manage your appetite. However, there is a simple formula by which you can calculate how much minimum amount of water your body needs. You can multiply your current weight by 35. It will give you a rough estimate in liters. For example, if I'm weighing 55 kilograms, I will multiply by 35. It will give me 1925, which is 1.925 liters, approximately 2 liters of water, which I need. Then, of course, we all need to do exercises, be it strength training or aerobic exercises. It's very important to limit alcohol to occasions, and that to maximum 60 ml. Now, very important in today's scenario is to avoid stress. Then is please enjoy your cheat meal once a week. Don't be deprived of your favorite foods. Otherwise, you will binge eat. You will crave more sweet foods or any of your comfort foods. So try and give yourself a treat. Then take it slow. There is nothing as quick fixes, so don't look for quick fixes. Rather, take your, you know, take yourself slow. Keep your body at rest and take it as slow as you can. Then is try and avoid working near the kitchen so that you don't make rounds to binge eat. Then is plan your meal timings as if you do when you go to regular office. Do not snack, but you please actually eat at proper times, like eat your breakfast, eat your lunch, eat your dinner. It's very important that you schedule your proper routine. then is be careful of too much caffeine, because I'm sure when we are sitting, we want to have, you know, a lot of coffee or a lot of tea, which again can give you digestive issues. To avoid that, maximum 2 or 3 cups of tea or coffee a day is okay, it's allowed. So when we are too much worried for our sudden weight gain, it's important to look at our plate and the portions we have added. So this is a beautiful slide, which you all can relate to. As a thumb rule, protein should be a palm size, then a fistful of vegetables is all you need, then starchy vegetables or starchy carbs like your rice, your bread, your rotis, etc. should be a palm size, and a thumb size of oil. Another important aspect to care while working from home is physical health. Even WHO has declared how important our physical health is, which is further taking care of your overall health. However, we always find reasons and get lazy. We all know that the benefits of being physically active are numerous. It lowers the risk of early death, lowers the risk of coronary heart disease, the stroke, high blood pressure. It helps in controlling your sugar levels, your blood profile level, and of course, weight gain. So there are few easy, simple solutions that we can take care to get up and get moving. Number one, every hour, try and get up from your computer and work around. Take your phone calls or texts while moving around. And if you have any terrace or balcony, you can stroll for 5 to 7 minutes in the afternoon to get the vitamin D as well. Then you can climb up and down your stairs if you have, or you can do sport jogging or sport running. Refer to some motivating YouTube channels for or exercises. You can even talk to a professional for help. There's so many YouTube channels these days that are giving online, you know, good links of exercises. You can refer to them. Then make your physical health a routine by setting up alarms or mark the calendars. It's very, very important. So this is the WHO recommendation, which says that we need to do the moderate kind of activities like walking, cycling for at least 150 minutes a week, which is 30 minutes per day, while slowly and gradually you can increase it to 300 minutes a week. For simple aerobic exercises like sport running, jogging, skipping, they can be performed in bouts of 10 minutes. So when you're being consistent and motivated to do any kind of physical activity, please remember to keep your goals as SMART. It's very, very important to reach your health goals. So I'll explain you, which is, so S stands for specific, which means your goal should be clear and specific. It is crucial to focus your effort towards one point and feel truly motivated to achieve it. For example, a general goal would be, I want to achieve a toned body. It's not, you know, it's not a SMART goal. It's just a general goal. While a SMART goal would be, I want to join a Zumba class online and I will surely try and attend at least 4 times a week. Then measurable, which is M. So it is important to measure your goals in order to track your progress. For example, you cannot measure a goal like you're eating healthy, but you can measure a goal like you're eating 1200 calories a day. Then is attainable, which is A. So ensure your goals are attainable. For example, setting a goal of reducing 4 to 5 kgs a month's time is not at all achievable, neither advisable by any health professional because of its harmful effects on the body. It can also demotivate you if you don't achieve that goal. Then R is realistic, wherein your goals should be practically achievable given the resources and time available. For example, if you do Zumba classes 7 days a week, may not be realistic if you have any other commitment towards your family or professional life. So make things that you can do and achieve the same. Then is trackable or time bound. Like your work, give your health goals some deadlines. For example, if you do a Zumba class from October, in order to improve muscle flexibility and strength, you will be able to work out at least 4 days a week, and every 15 days, you will be able to target 1 kg weight loss. So like this, you will be able to track that in October month, in 1 month time, I'll be able to lose 2 kgs of fat. So here are some of the easy peasy ways to work out while we are working from home without any special equipments, and that too result oriented. Trust me, I also do this often. And these will help you to lose that stubborn fat while strengthening the body muscles and increasing the heart and breathing rates, thus lowers the risk of anxiety as well. Now, these exercises are really quick and easy and can be easily found at WHO website. So some of them are knee to elbow, plank, back extensions, chair dip. As you can see, there's nothing that you need, you know, no special equipments, nothing, just little space or some chair. Then is walking lunges, simple workout, Surya Namaskar and jumping jack. So skipping workout is again a full body workout that you can do easily. Surya Namaskar, my personal favorite. It's again a full body workout where, you know, not too much space is required, but yes, you need to do each and every posture in a very, you know, in a scientific way. And also you should be sure what poses you are doing. Otherwise you'll end up having backache. Okay. So now comes something which we all need at this point of time, is the snacks we can munch on, and that too at odd hours. So here are some lists that I have provided. You can have, one cup of sprouts when you're too hungry. You can have a glass of vegetable juice. You can have one cup of plain popcorn. You can have any leftover poha or upma. You can even have two boiled eggs. You can have open sandwiches of multigrain bread, and you can have vegetable toppings on this. And then you can have homemade makhanas or, you know, moong dal khakra, etc. Yeah. So coming on to the home remedies that can help you knock off that extra weight are certain, you know, kitchen herbs, again, that you can easily find at your home. And they're all the time available. And at the same time, they boost our metabolism. Of course, not just they help in breaking the stubborn fat, but they help in building our immunity. Now, for example, you can start having cinnamon tea. All you need to do is to add 1 to 2 teaspoons of cinnamon powder to a glass of warm water and drink it on empty daily basis. Then you can have aloe vera water. Here you can consume 1 cup of unsweetened aloe vera juice every day. You can even have the fresh aloe vera if you have any plant nearby. All you need to do is to scrape a little bit, add it in blender, put a little water, and you are done. You can have this water. Then ginger tea, simply add 1 teaspoon of grated ginger to a cup of hot water and steep for 7 minutes. Then you can have CCF tea, which is cinnamon, cumin, and fennel tea. Simply boil all of these 1/2 teaspoon in for 2 minutes, let it cool and keep sipping. They can be taken 30 minutes before meals. Then you can have cumin, which is zero water. You can soak it overnight. And next day you can boil for 2 minutes, let it cool and drink. So although, you know, there's so many herbal remedies floating around, but these are just the gist. You can do as per your health issues also. So, you know, you can try some of them. Then comes the most obvious question at this point of time. Is there anything to lose weight faster? And the obvious answer is no. There's nothing quick fix or fads or any magic wand by which we lose our weight overnight. It's all about eating healthy in moderate amount while keeping yourself physically fit, mentally positive, and most importantly, make your health a priority and a routine. Okay, so this clearly shows that an effective weight gain happens when calorie consumption is more than energy expenditure, when the input is more and there is no output, and we are storing excess body fat in body tissues, maybe as visceral fat or subcutaneous fat. Now the subcutaneous fat, they lie inside the skin, so excess will eventually have many health issues. And if you are doing good, you know, exercises, then the energy expenditure is more. And if you're taking care of your eating patterns, then the daily consumed calories will be less. And eventually burning of calories from stored body fat will happen and you will be able to lose weight. So here's the much awaited health plan for a healthy living, but please make sure that this is just a sample and it may vary from person's medical issues, likes, dislikes, allergies, and of course, lifestyle. So this is just a sample plan where, you know, you can start your day with just a glass of water, a warm water, or any nuts that you have. And then your breakfast can be a homemade upma or a bowl of cereal like cornflakes or oats or any cereal that you like in toned milk. Or if you eat non-veg, then you can have boiled eggs with a slice of whole grain bread or fruits. Then the mid-morning can be around 10:30 to 11:30. And you can grab there a bowl of fruit or, like papaya, apples or grapes with some amount of nuts. Then lunch can either be lunch, you have your staple meal. So you can have brown rice with vegetables or two rotis with vegetables, a bowl of dal and a bowl of low fat yogurt. Then evening is the time where most of us feel too hungry. We get our hunger pangs at this point of time, but please be mindful and try and have, ginger tea with light snacks like makhanas or puffed rice with peanuts. You can even have a tall glass of milk or any fruit-based milkshake over here. Try and have early dinner between 7:30 to 8:30 is a good time. And you can have grilled paneer with a bowl of dal with lots of vegetables. Or you can have grilled chicken or fish with a glass of lemon juice. And one serving of carbohydrate is very important. Like you can have a katori of boiled rice, you can have thin chapati. Okay, so this is my personal favorite because, whenever I don't want to cook but want to order from outside something healthy, I usually apply this, which is a GPRS rule, where G means grilled, P is poached, R is roasted, S is steamed or sauteed. So easy to remember, right? So next time, whenever you wish to order from outside, try and apply this GPRS rule. Now, this is a sample detox plan again, which should only be done fortnightly. And please, please don't do it on everyday basis. This is just to flush out the toxins and give rest to your organs. Again, this is just a sample plan and it may vary from person to person depending on his health, his current lifestyle, his likes, dislikes, etc. So here you can start your day with jasmine tea or any other herbal tea that you have around. You can have some fruits and you can have water. You can even have some nuts in the morning. Then for breakfast, you can have a glass of vegetable juices like carrot, aloe vera, beetroot, ginger, amla, lauki, cucumber. These are all summer vegetables and they are all over the place. However, you can mix and match whatever vegetables you are having right now at the moment. Or if you like egg whites, you can have them or any cereal with skimmed milk. For lunch, keep it as light as possible. You can have boiled rice with simple dal or vegetables with a bowl of salad and dahi, or you can have khichdi with dahi as well to make it very simple. Then at 4 p.m., you can have a bowl of fruits or any milk-based or fruit-based milkshake, or you can have your herbal tea or any homemade herbal, spiced tea as well, along with little nuts. Then for dinner, you can either have a medium-sized katori of dal with some steamed vegetables. You can have dal-based soups with steamed vegetables. You can have chicken soup also, or you can have any vegetable soup with small amount of paneer. So what if I don't control my weight is very, very important because it's very important to take charge of your health and lose that excess body fat that you're carrying or you're piling with time. This is the time if you feel that you're gaining weight, this is the right time where you can feel, you can start doing certain exercises. You can start cutting down the calories. Of course, don't fall prey into fad diets or quick fixes. Rather have things which are sustainable and realistic as we discussed before in SMART goals. So, if you don't control your weight, there are certain underlying issues like stress, anxiety, or, any health parameters erupt, for example, osteoarthritis, then the most common is diabetes these days, then one can have coronary heart diseases, hypertension, etc., etc. Okay, so now these are just the gist of our webinar. Get up and move. It's as simple as that. Please, for every 1 hour that you're sitting, stand up for 3 minutes and walk around. Then don't be away from your friends or your colleagues. Just get connected to them. ditch that sugar. It's very important. Then set up your routine, because that will, you know, help you feel better emotionally and mentally as well. And it will help you being productive and organized at the same time. And then try and work in a healthy environment so that, again, you can take care of your mental and physical health. So with this, I hope I could give some insight on losing weight in an effective way while working from home. And I'm sure you will be able to apply to your current life soon. Thank you so much for listening. And now I'm open for any Q&As.
Yeah, Harshita, thanks for the wonderful and crisp presentation, I would say. Right. Thank you. So I'll take a few questions. The first one is, can you please suggest how to break the weight loss plateau?
So, you know, weight loss plateau happens when you do repeated diets. So one thing is that to take, you know, to break that in between, if you're doing diets for about, you know, 6 months time or 1 year, take a break for about 1 month in between, eat your regular food, because that will give you kickstart, you know, that will boost your metabolism again. Eat your regular dal, chawal, rice, whatever you are having. Otherwise, what you can do is increase more proteins and limit the carbs. Howsoever, I call that as a fat diet, but the best thing is to break your routine altogether, get out of that diet zone and try and eat normal.
Okay, thank you for that. Next up is, what is your suggestion on whey protein supplements? Are they okay or no?
So supplements, like I told you before, I am not a big fan of supplements, but if you're making whey protein at home, which you can easily get it from paneer, when you make, you know, paneer out of milk, you can get the whey water, you can use them instead of having, you know, synthetic proteins from outside.
Okay. And what is your take on flax seeds?
Absolutely. Flax seeds are very healthy. They are rich in omega-3 fatty acids. Yeah. They contain good amount of fiber, so one can easily have it. Of course, don't overboard, like, you know, just have in moderation. So about 1 to 2 teaspoons a day is required. And also, whenever one is taking flax seeds, it's very important that you are having a lot of water with it, because it's full of fiber. It should not get stuck into intestines and you are having constipation issues. So whenever you're having good amount of fiber, make sure that you're even having a lot of water.
Okay. Next up is, can you please explain how much energy is needed for a healthy individual in a day?
Okay, energy as in the calorie?
I think they are asking for the calories. Intake.
See, a healthy individual for a moderate exercise, a person in males should be having about 2000 calories. This is an approximate energy kilocalorie that I'm talking about, while a female can have about 1700 calories to 1800 calories a day with moderate exercises. I'm not talking about sedentary lifestyle here.
Yeah, and this is for a healthy individual.
Healthy individual.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Okay. And it almost in continuation with this, how do we know that how much exercise would burn how many calories?
So there are certain apps available and they are, you know, you can get from them. So for example, you know, there is a beautiful chart from FSSI where you will be able to see how much energy expenditure is there per hour. For example, if you're sitting, you are just burning 86 kilocalorie per hour. While if you're running or jogging, you are burning approximately 700 to 800 kilocalorie per hour. So there are plenty apps available. Otherwise, the most authentic website is this, your WHO and FSSI. Of course, ICMR also.
Okay. Next is, what is the role of fasting in losing weight? And what should be the method of fasting, if at all?
See, fasting, as I told, don't fast for a prolonged period of time. If you want to fast, do it every fortnightly. You can do that just to flush out the toxins, as I explained earlier. So intermittent fasting is one thing that is a trend now. You can do that. You can do salt-free fasting. You can do grain-free fasting. You can do lactose-free fasting. There are so many fasts that you can do, but I would suggest that do it only fortnightly. Otherwise, if you keep having it, you are just going to ruin your metabolism and your health. You will end up having deficiencies as well.
Okay. Then is, what should be the ideal gap between two meals? Although I think you've covered in the presentation, but maybe if you can reiterate.
So ideally we say 2.5 to 3 hours. We need to digest the previous meal also. So for example, if you're having your breakfast between 9, 9:30, it's advisable that you have your lunch between 12 and 1.
Okay. Right. And I think in continuation with the previous thing, what about the diabetic patients? Can they do the fasting or no? Or is it not recommended?
See, ideally, I don't recommend fast for diabetics because they have to have their medicines also. Otherwise, they'll end up having hypoglycemia, which is low blood sugar. So only when your doctor has prescribed, you can do that. Otherwise, it is not advisable at all. You can eat moderation, or you can limit your carbs, you can increase your proteins, but don't fast as such.
Okay. I think that's a fair point. Next up is, now these days, since we are having restricted activities and we are, homebound, is keto diet a recommendation or intermittent fasting? Out of these two, what do you recommend?
So both of these are fad diets. I will not recommend both of these. Rather, please get up and, move around, eat healthy. Otherwise, if you do keto diet or any intermittent fasting, you'll end up having that kind of diet. You're not going to do any physical activity. So make it a point that you have your, routine, you are having fixed schedule. You can play anything on YouTube or on your, TV. Play with your little kids if you have around. So, but all in all, I will not suggest that you are doing any fad at this point of time, because, this time we also have to see our immunity, which you can't play around with.
Okay. Can you please suggest few immunity booster food items?
See, there's so many immunity boosters available in our kitchen already. You can have mix of ginger with amla and turmeric. You can have a lot of proteins, include proteins in your meals, have one serving in each meal. Have healthy fats for that matter. Try and have ghar ka bana hua ghee or have white butter. They are also good. Have a handful of nuts. Otherwise, there's nothing a quick fix. You will not get out of overnight. The immunity will be able to build. It will build, through. So you can't see that, you're having ginger today and you're free from diseases tomorrow. It's nothing like that.
I think everything has to be in continuation and we need to be consistent with that. That's the key.
Exactly, Surbit.
Great. Maybe we'll take the last question, Ashita. What is the role of vitamin C in times like this?
Of course, vitamin C is very, very much needed. It is full of immunity. You can, have about 500 milligrams to 1000 milligrams a day. And you can increase in the form of amla. You can have oranges. You can even have supplements. There are good supplements available. So vitamin C is equally important these days. And try and include as much as you can, because it will eventually protect your immunity for sure.
Okay. So maybe just last one, I am getting repeated requests from this person. So it goes like this. I am not able to eat my regular meal in full. And whenever I'm doing that, I have to leave it in between and I feel nauseatic and I have to do the vomiting also at times. So although there can be some medical underlying issue.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So it's very important to see a doctor first. Try and tell your doctor what are the causes, you know, what is the root cause that you're having such problem. Otherwise, break your meals. For example, have small portion of breakfast, then every 1 hour, try and have something or the other. Don't have everything at once just to finish a proper meal. You can break your meals also. Howsoever, I would strongly suggest that please talk to your doctor.
Absolutely. But still very well said. Great. So I think we've had a wonderful session, no doubt about it. Harshita, thanks so much for taking us through these tips. And I am very much thankful to the audience as well for their keen participation. And with this, on behalf of Dr. Reddy's, I thank you, Harshita, and all the participants for taking time out. And we wish you that all your days be full of positivity and good health, because good health can't wait. Thank you and Jai Hind.